All right, we're cooking. So, sterile processing department. Let's draw a picture of it, shall we? Here it is. Sterile processing department. One fantastic little rectangle. Okay? So, what's involved? We have to break it down into little sections. Remember, what were the main principles of sterile processing?
No one is dirty.
Don't be ashamed. Don't be bashful. What were the things that we just talked about?
No one is dirty.
No one is dirty.
No one is clean.
No one is clean.
No one is sterile.
No one is sterile.
Keep them separate.
Okay, well, first things first, let's separate our department into clean and dirty. Here we go. And just to say that we mean business, I'm going to separate it with two lines. Dirty, clean. Who is the number one customer of the sterile processing department? Does anybody know?
The operating room.
That's right. They are the biggest customer. Why? Because we get to decontaminate, clean, disinfect, sterilize, package, and repackage their toys, meaning surgical instruments. Okay? Make sense? So our journey towards from dirty to clean has to come from somewhere, and it's going to start with dirty. So I'm going to draw something over here, and this guy right over here is our elevator. And this elevator usually brings stuff from the operating room to the dirty side of the sterile processing department. And we receive our instruments from the operating room in carts. So a cart from the operating theater shows up filled with yucky surgical instruments. We sent them clean, they sent us dirty. Okay, so this elevator comes in, okay? And this guy only opens one way, and it opens this way, and a little cart with wheels comes out this way. So, dirty cart. Now, what happens to the dirty cart? Now, on that dirty cart, we have a whole big mess of surgical instruments coming in from the operating room. Okay? We have to check him in. It's like a librarian sitting in the library and a whole mess of library books just came in. By the way, have you ever taken a book out from the library?
Yeah.
They checked it out and checked it back in, right? So they know exactly when you took it out and when you brought it back in. Otherwise, you have to pay a fine. Am I wrong? Come on, tell me I'm right. I need a little reinforcement. So at this particular point in time, we check in at the check-in station. We process all the stuff that comes in dirty. Now, at this point in time, we don't really know if everything that we checked out originally is there because it's a big mess of stuff. Imagine carts and carts and carts inside that cart, little baskets of stuff that supposedly says, you know, this type of a procedure, this type of a procedure, this type, or this kit, and that kit. We have a basket and we take it for their word that this stuff came back in. So we check that in. So, right over here, we have a check-in area, during which time we check in what's on the cart. So whatever they told us there is supposedly there, at least the carrier for all of our instruments that has a little barcode tag on it. We go beep, scanned it in, right? Okay, very nice. From this point on, this stuff goes into our area where we begin to wash the instruments. So we unload the cart and we place the instruments on the counter. So let's say...
Is that what you call the kitchen?
Yes. As a matter of fact, this is the decontamination area. And the decontamination area is oftentimes referred to as the kitchen. So we unload the dirty cart. And guess what happens? Once the cart is unloaded, we want to send it out of here because it doesn't want to stay. So I'm going to make one more area over here. We're going to draw this little cart. And this guy over here is the cart wash. So we wash the cart. The cart is going to come in here from the dirty side, make a U-turn, and head straight into the cart wash. And from the cart wash, it's going to come out on the clean cart. Okay? Does this make sense? It doesn't stay on the dirty side. It makes a U-turn into the cart washer, gets washed, and bingo, straight out of the dirty side. Now, on the instrument counter, we proceed to our three sink setup. Okay? Soak, wash, rinse, just like in the kitchen. So far, so good?
Yes.
Okay, now. Yes, dear.
When we soak the instrument, after, when we need to wash it, we cannot wash it with cold water or hot water?
That's a good question. I'm going to come to that in a minute. So the question is, how do we soak the instrument? Cold water or hot water? The quick answer is neither.
Warm.
And we'll talk about it later once we discuss this. Okay? Soak, wash, rinse. But I got to tell you something about the water here. Water must be purified. Exclamation point. Okay? Either by RODI or distilled. And we'll come back to this later. So our sinks should be not like the sinks that we use at home or any place else. We should be using sinks which have reverse osmosis deionized water or distilled water. More than likely, that would be this guy right over here. Okay? And we'll talk about this more extensively. So we manually wash our instruments right here. And this would be, as I'm going to just put it here, we're going to call it manual wash. And we're going to talk about manual wash more extensively. Right now, it's just key generic concepts as to how the sterile processing department is structured. From here, we move our slightly cleaned instruments, and we're going to say move cleaned instruments to mechanical washers. The first type of mechanical washer, we'll put it here, is something called a ultrasonic washer. We're going to talk about the ultrasonic washer more extensively. Right now, it's just the layout. So, we went from manual to ultrasonic, which is the first step in mechanical washing. So, cleaned instruments go to mechanical washers. The first step in mechanical washing is the ultrasonic cleaner. Ultrasonic washer, ultrasonic cleaner, it doesn't matter what you call it. As long as the word ultrasonic appears in this. Okay? So, this is where we are right now. So this is step two in the washing process. So far, so good? Okay. Once this cycle is complete, we take out our instruments and we physically load them into 1, 2, 3, 4, however many mechanical washers. Okay? So these are our mechanical washers, disinfectors. These are like dishwashers. Like dishwashers in your kitchen. Stuff comes in over here and comes out on the clean side. Okay? Doors open sequentially. When one door is open, the other door is closed. So never do the two communicate. Okay? Does this make sense? Now, I left this blank right over here. I'm gonna come back to this. So I'm gonna put a little X over here. And if I forget to get back to this, you let me know. We need to discuss this area right over here. So now we find ourselves on the quote-unquote clean side. I'm going to separate the clean side just a little bit, right over here. Notice I didn't put a solid line over here, but a dashed line, okay? That doesn't mean that when you get to the department, you'll see a dashed line on the floor that separates this half right over here. Now, this is the clean half, right? We used to be dirty over here. Now we're clean over here. Now, this area right over here, and I'm going to make some more pictures over here of little tables. So these are our tables. All right, I'm just going to draw four because I draw big. These are tables. And this area right over here is called prep and pack. Prep and pack is short for preparation and packaging. You should understand, when I use words like the kitchen or prep and pack, these are all examples of something interesting called professional jargon. Okay, jargon. In French, jargon. Whatever it is in French, I make up French all the time. Okay, as I go along. But the fact of the matter is, I'm pretty sure that it's true. Those of you that speak French probably know that there is such a word. It's not an English word. I think it's a French word. So in any case, it's professional jargon. Try not to use that type of language with people other than folks that work in your department. Certainly do not put it in your report. I spend 2 hours at the kitchen. What? What kitchen? No. You know, call these things by their professional name, by their God-given name. If it's prep and pack, it's preparation and packaging, okay? And the name speaks for itself. This is where you prepare and package your instruments. So whatever came out over here, remember, we checked it in. Here is where the whatever hits the fan. This is where we get to find out what did they actually send us back. Why? Because on this side, it's safe for us to handle instruments with our bare hands. Because guess what? They're clean. They're disinfected. And we're going to talk about the word disinfected shortly. Okay? We're going to talk about the word clean. We're going to talk about the words dirty. We're going to talk about the word ultrasonic, mechanical washers. All these things we're going to discuss in just a minute. Okay? But for now, just the generic concepts. Are you with me so far?
Yes.
Can I get an amen? Okay. Once we prepare and package our instruments, I better get an amen from somebody later. Once we prepare and package our instruments, we're ready to sterilize them. And guess what? Right over here, in this row, however many sterilizers and however many different types we have them right here. So I'm going to paint them with a broad brush and say, sterilizers. This little guy right over here where my coffee is, sterilizer. So they have a whole bunch of walk-in ones over there, or drive-in ones, or whatever the size. You can have one as big as anything you want. Okay, it all depends on your needs. But the general ones would probably fit about five of me inside, maybe more, depending how you want to position. Of course, what will come out would be an ugly, disgusting mess, and you don't want to see it, but I'm just giving you the size and the volume of the general hospital unit, okay? And so, once this comes out of the sterilizers, it is considered to be sterile. So, just the clean packaged stuff comes in, okay? And what comes out is something sterile. Over here, we have what we call sterile storage. This is the Holy of Holies. Nobody except designated people go in there. It's a very special, very delicate area where only sterile packages and only required personnel are. Does that make sense? All right. Now, this is your basic layout of the department. Except I forgot my little X over here. This little X represents an air lock that separates the clean and the dirty side, through which personnel can pass without allowing the air to mix from one side to the other, and by allowing ourselves to change into proper personal protective equipment. So this guy right over here serves as the airlock. You can change, you can bring stuff across if necessary, and you can only bring stuff across from clean to dirty, not from dirty to clean. Please understand that, okay? And so people come in here, change, and get in here. People walk out to get in from dirty side to clean side. You get into the airlock, you change, you put on, you know, clean uniform, and you come out. Never do you just waltz in one side and waltz out the other. Doesn't work that way, I'm sorry. Because remember, know what is clean, know what is dirty, know what is sterile, keep them separate, right? Principles of the sterile processing department are very simple, but they're solid. You don't break them. You don't violate these rules, because if you violate these rules, there's nothing sterile. What are we talking about? I mean, this is simple stuff, right? Know what's dirty, know what's clean, know what's sterile, keep them separate. This is separate. This is sterile. We keep it separate from everyone, and only when it's needed to go back to the operating room, it goes to one more elevator, usually not the dirty one, the clean one. So we would have two of them, and clean stuff would get on that elevator and go back up. Okay? Usually the sterile processing department is downstairs. Why? I don't know. You'll find in different places, they're usually right next to the kitchen.
Yeah.
It boggles the mind. I don't know why they do that. So on one hand, the food comes in. On the other hand, the dirty stuff from surgery comes down. Don't ask me. There's a few places that the sterile processing department is actually on the upper levels. I only know two hospitals in the area. One Tufts, and the other one in Rhode Island Hospital has their sterile processing department on the 7th floor.
Oh, good. Upstairs.
Upstairs.
Yeah.
Yeah. The rest in the basement. I never understood why.
Yeah.
In the basement, you find the kitchen, sterile processing, and the morgue. Great company. Okay? So is this clear? All right. Now, let's talk about some of the details. Remember what they say, the devil's in the details. So, let's talk about the details. First things first, we have to understand something about how we further provide the separation, physical separation between dirty and clean. It's not just the wall, but what's also separated is the air. And first thing we have to remember, is this clear?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Can I erase this?
Yeah.
All right. I mean, I feel bad erasing such magnificent piece of art, but, all right, at least I have it on video. Remember what I tell you, folks, not everything in the book is on the test, but everything I put on the board is. And the most important thing about taking the test, and the most important thing about studying your notes, is being able to retain the content and not to learn the questions from the test that we have here. I teach you one way, and then I ask you questions another way. I ask you questions on the quizzes, and I ask you questions to fill in on the computer. They're asked differently, okay? It's only designed to throw you off. It's not designed to help you remember the questions. Remembering the questions will lead you to failing the test. If you memorize the questions and the answers on the test that I give you, you're going to go into the Isham test, and you're going to sit down, and the first thing you'll see is a question that you've never seen before. And from then, it's all downhill. All right? So let it drop, and most importantly, understand what I'm teaching you. Once you understand the content, they can't fool you with a different style of asking the same question. Make sense? So, we move on. Again. I'm gonna make it a little bit more simplistic. So this is dirty. This is clean. And this is sterile. Right? So I told you it's not about just physical separations. It's also about air separation. This is the dirty side. This is the dirtiest place in the entire hospital. The absolute filthiest, nastiest place. Not because nobody takes care of it, but because all the disease-laden instruments show up over here. There is no dirtier place in there, in the hospital, than this room. So, since we're talking about a really dirty place, please remember that you must wear your PPE, or personal protective even if you have to just run into the decontamination area. You must change into the full PPE. The whole thing needs to be worn. Booties, gown, face mask, hair cover. Of course, hair cover you wear all the time in the department. You don't take that off. Always wear the hair cover. Now, the full outfit, full PPE. It's a bummer. You got to run in there for 30 seconds to give somebody a message or to just give them a piece of equipment. Here, please do this. You got to change. You got to gown up. Remember what I told you, right? When we talked about universal or standard precautions, rather, I told you that standard precautions, and those of you who are new, you'll get this on the other side, but I'll repeat. Standard precautions is a state of mind where you believe that everyone around you and everything that you come in contact with in the hospital is contaminated and contagious, and most importantly, it will kill you. If you remember that it'll kill you, believe me, you won't mind dressing up in a full PPE for 30 seconds because you know darn well that you don't want to die. It's not about going to a doctor and getting a shot. No, it doesn't work that way. If you think that a shot will fix you, you are wrong. Because shots will never fix you. You will be hospitalized. And remember what I tell you. You know, we're in the middle of a biological war. There is bacteria out there, there are viruses out there that people have no clue. They don't even know how to diagnose them. And those that they do know how to diagnose will eat your flesh right off of you before they can do anything. All right, this is nasty business. Don't play with it. And always wash your hands, wash your face, wash your nose. Okay, all that stuff goes in there. You know, don't be afraid and don't feel that somebody's watching you and somebody's rushing you along. No, 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 no. Without you, there's no sterile processing. Without you, patients don't get their care. So take the extra moment to take care of yourself, because if you don't, no one else will. Okay, so we separate the air. In order to separate the air from this nasty, dirty side, we have to make sure that no air escapes from here. So, remember this. We operate in this side under negative air pressure. What that means is that we suck in more air than we blow out. So when you open the door to sterile processing, actually it could be hard to open the door because it keeps sucking it in. You open the door and you feel like you're being pulled in. That's negative air pressure. In other words, we suck in the cleaner air from the rest, and I say cleaner, not clean. We suck in the cleaner air from the rest of the hospital into our decontamination area, which is this place right over here. And we have to make sure that the air is circulated and is not stagnant. Therefore, and this is key, please remember that our air must be exchanged 10 times per hour, or as they call 10 C, or I'll just say it, complete air, exchanges per hour. Now, here's where I have a little homework for you. In your books, please find out for me temperature and humidity for this area.
How many times per hour do it?
10 complete air exchanges per hour. 10 complete air exchanges per hour. That's how we recirculate the air on the dirty side. Make sense? So not only do we keep the pressure negative, but we also exchange the air 10 times completely per hour. So the air is not stagnant. The air has to move. Otherwise, if it sits there, all these bacteria will become very comfortable. They find a pool of water somewhere, get in there, and starts reproducing. And remember what I tell you about microorganisms. Microorganisms like conditions to be wet, warm, and dark. People who have been in the class already know this. People who haven't been, please write this down. Microorganisms like wet, warm, dark places. So the question is, if the microorganisms like wet, warm, and dark, what conditions should the department provide?
Huh?
Light.
Cold.
Dry. Thank you. You guys are all geniuses. So if the bacteria, viruses, prions, spores, and all the other, gang of murderers that we have over there, right? If they like to reproduce in wet, warm, and dark places, okay, then we need to provide dry, cold, and bright. That's why, next time you go to the hospital in general, please pay attention. It's always uncomfortably cold and dry in there. Why? And the lights always stink. I mean, they're always like these horrible fluorescent lights everywhere. And everybody is uncomfortable. If you've ever been in a hospital, if you ever stayed in a hospital, all right, recall your stay. You always ask for another blanket. Because it's cold. Oh, I'm sick. Why is this cold in there? Well, because it's supposed to be in this environment. Otherwise, it would be nice and pleasant and the windows would be open and the fresh air would come in. Well, they would do that, but too many people jumped out of their windows, so they opted out for this. It's true. In any event, here we go. When we get to the clean side is different from the dirty side. Because the dirty side, we wanted to suck the air in from the rest of the hospital because our air is dirty, negative air pressure. On these sides, we have positive air pressure. Because we don't want to take the dirtier air from the outside and bring it in. We want to take our clean air and blow it out. So when you open the door, if you've ever been to the Park Street train station as it goes down below, you open the door and you get hit with that nasty smelling, stream of warm air. And you have to fight to get in there. That's what you call positive air pressure. Everybody know what I'm talking about? And I'm telling you, just for the sake of interest, go over to the Park Street station. Try to open that door. It hits you in the face every time. Now that's positive air pressure. There's only one difference between the preparation and packaging side and the sterile side, and that's the amount of air movement that we have. Now, on this particular side, just like on the dirty side, we have 10 complete air exchanges on this side. This is CAE, complete air exchanges, okay? That's on the preparation and packaging side. However, on the sterile side, we only have 4 complete air exchanges. Because on this side, not only do we not want people to walk around, those that don't belong in the department, we also don't want the extra air to move on this side. So, also, homework assignment, please find for me temperature and humidity for both these sides. This is important because I assure you it will be on the test. Make sense? So remember, as you, and I'll tell you what chapter to review afterwards, you'll find it. Okay? Does this make sense? Does it? Not much more left as far as the layout of the department is concerned. So now all we have to do is go back to where we started, talk about the water, talk about the cleaning process, talk about the decontamination process. All right? Fair? Any questions so far? Mm-hmm. Going once, going twice? Gone. This is a fine room. This is a lot of pertinent information. This is a lot of stuff. All right, so at some point in time, if I look at you and I see your eyes are glazed over, I'm going to stop. Because this is really a lot of stuff that we have to cover right now. Okay, let's talk about cleaning, shall we? Remember, know what is clean, or actually, know what is dirty, know what is clean, know what is sterile, keep the separate. Okay, so let's talk about cleaning. According to my mother, all brilliant people either misspell words or drop letters from the word. As, of course, you may have seen me drop letters and misspell stuff, that must mean that I'm brilliant. Thank you. In any case, moving right along. Let's define cleaning. We have to define everything that we come in contact with. So let's define cleaning. It's very important for us to know the definition of cleaning.
Definition of cleaning, it's remove all invisible, visible and invisible gross form.
Nice. I'll repeat it. So cleaning is, don't write it down yet, let me say it. You absorb it, then I write it down. Okay? So cleaning. It's the removal of gross, visible, and invisible soil. By the word gross, I don't mean yucky. Oh, it's gross. No. Gross is a German word, means big. Grand would be an English equivalent. So, cleaning, removal of gross, visible, and invisible soil. From where? It doesn't matter. In our case, it's surgical instruments. In other people's case, it could be underwear. It makes no difference. In case of underwear, it's the other kind of gross. Oh, it's gross, and it's true. Make sense? I always wondered why in the military many years ago they handed out to everybody green underwear. I found out later why it was green. In any case, socks too. Socks were also green. In any event, removal of gross, visible, and invisible soil. Our first start of cleaning, as you may recall, was the manual washing in a three-sink setup, right? Soak, wash, rinse, right? And I told you that we need special kind of water to do our soaking, washing, and rinsing. Did I not? I did. Okay, so let's start talking about water. Water is our primary instrument for cleaning, not just in sterile processing, okay? Because water, which is also known as a wetting agent, it's also known as a universal solvent. Meaning if you leave something in the water long enough, it'll dissolve it, right? It's like you wash your dishes, or you didn't wash your dishes after a large party at home, right? And then you come back and say, holy cow, everything is caked on. Oh, well, I'm just going to throw it in the sink and pour some water over it and let it sit there. And lo and behold, you come back, hopefully, stuff has dissolved and all you got to do is just rinse it off, right? Well, that's water for you. Water destroys mountains. Okay, now, we have to spend a fair amount of time on the water. All right, water being H2O, which is the pure form of water. I'm here to tell you that it does not exist in nature. No way. No way. As soon as God made it, it ceased to exist. H2O, here you go, planet Earth, bang. As soon as the water landed over here, H2O became H2O plus whatever dirt it fell into. Because whatever it dissolved into itself. And now the water you drink, you know, God help you if you know what's in your tap water, but I suggest you find out before next time you make yourself a cup of coffee or a cup of tea. Never use that stuff. That's nasty. The only reason it's clear and white looking is because they dumped enough chlorine in there in order to change its color. Otherwise, believe me, it's nasty, 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 nasty. H2O, pure form of water, does not exist in nature. I'll tell you what else H2O does not do. H2O, or pure form of water, does not conduct, and I'm going to put a little lightning rod over here to say that it does not conduct electricity. Pure water, rather H2O, does not conduct electricity. It doesn't happen. It's hydrogen, which is a gas. It's oxygen, which is a gas. These two gases do not conduct electricity. When they're together and they form water, they still don't conduct electricity. However, if you put a pinch of salt in there, all of a sudden, all the electricity you want will go right through you. Okay? That's why they tell you, don't watch TV in the bathtub. Don't blow dry your hair in the bathtub. You drop that stuff in there, you'll fry yourself. I've never seen it happen, but I guess it's possible. You've heard that before, right? Just like you don't walk down the street during a thunderstorm and you touch a wet electric pole. You will die.
Don't watch TV in the bathtub?
Yeah, if you drop the television set in your bathtub, supposedly there's enough current in there to fry you.
Oh.
Yeah. But H2O, or pure water, no electricity. It's a very important factor for us to remember. Because when we make pure water, we actually test its purity by conducting electricity through it. So, a few terms that we have to remember. Well, actually, before I go there, let's discuss a couple of other things about water that you should know. Water boils at 100 degrees Celsius or 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Under regular pressure at sea level. If I decrease the pressure on the water will boil sooner or at lower temperature. If the water is dirty, it'll boil at a higher temperature. Like, for example, I don't know about you, but when I was a young boy and my grandmother taught me how to cook for myself, one of the first things that they teach how to cook would be eggs, right? You can't screw that up, really. So, hard-boiled egg. Did anybody ever teach you how to boil an egg?
Yes, you put the egg in the water and then a little bit of salt.
You put a little bit of salt before, then you put an egg in there. And it all depends. So why do you put salt in the water? It ain't for flavor. The egg's inside the shell. I always wonder, said Grandma. Lucky for me, my grandma was a chemist. I said, Grandma, why did you put salt in the water? Don't you want to put salt on the egg afterwards? And Grandma said, no, son. Once I put salt in the water, it's no longer water. It's water plus salt. That means it boils at a higher temperature. That means my egg boils faster. Right? It depends what kind of an egg you want, right? If you want to boil an egg, you know, that it's completely hard all the way through, you put it in the water beforehand. But if you want it hard on the outside and soft and gooey on the inside, you put it after the water boils, right? All these little tricks of the trade. I think they call them eggs Benedict. I could be wrong. So to make a long story short, under normal pressure conditions, the water boils, and if it's clean, it boils at 100 degrees Celsius or 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Both temperatures are equal. I know. It's because we live in the United States, the most confused country in the world as far as temperatures and distances are concerned. And of course, weights too. I mean, you can get a 2-liter bottle of Coke and 1 gallon of milk all in the same place. Right? Okay. What's even worse is going from America to Canada. Ever make that trip in the car? All of a sudden, you're driving 65 miles per hour. Next thing you know, the sign says 100. And if you didn't pay attention, it's little letters next to it says KMH, or kilometers per hour, which is less than 65 miles per hour. And you want to go 100 on a very small road. And then the police officer stops you to, Monsieur, do you know how fast you were going? I said, I was going 90, well below the speed limit. He says, no. It is kilometers, you dummy, kilometers. Okay, it's a different unit of measure. Make sense? So far, so good? Right?
Yes.
Fantastic. So, and if I take a pot of dirty water and I start to boil it at 100 degrees Celsius or 212 degrees Fahrenheit, my clean water that's already boiling is going to start evaporating. The dirty water stays in the pot, but the clean water is escaping as steam. If I capture that steam into a little funnel, then run it through a little cooling or condensing coil, that water is going to start dripping out of that coil, and guess what kind of water that is? Distilled. Or pure H2O. If you're ever in the condition where you really need water and there's no clean water anywhere, boil it, but don't drink the stuff that you've been boiling. Catch the steam, condense it, and drink that. Because the stuff that stays behind, I'll draw you a picture. So this is our pot of water. This is our heat. All right, this would be steam. I'm going to catch the steam in a funnel, condense it in a coil, and I'm going to have these little drops of water come into my cup. And this is going to be distilled water. Okay? So, let me tell you something. Have you ever left a pot that you started boiling for tea on the pot, on the stove, and forgot about it, and you come back, it used to be full, now it's only half? You know what I'm talking about? Or you may have put your soup on to warm up, and you forgot about it, and you come back, there used to be soup, now there's just vegetables and some chicken somewhere in the bottom all burning, right? What happened to the water? It evaporated. Where did it go? Somewhere. If you caught it, you would have distilled water. But because you didn't, now you have what used to be soup. So now, if I take this water and I boil it out, what's going to be left over here? Dirty water. The more you boil, the dirtier the water becomes. So next time they tell you to boil your water and drink it, or you think, oh, I know the water is no good, but I boiled it. It's okay. When you boiled it, you simply made it dirtier. Remember, you're just concentrating. When the clean water evaporated and it went over here, what's left over? Dirty water. This process is called distillation. And if you remember from my description earlier, this is one of the two acceptable means of having pure water in the department. Distillation, or what they call reverse osmosis deionized water filtration. And I'm going to talk about that right now. Does this make sense? Okay, are we okay with distillation? Fantastic. Now let's talk about RODI, which is much more important to us than distillation. By the way, distilled water you can buy in CVS, Walgreens, or Stop and Shop. Any water with a red cap is distilled.
Can you drink distilled water?
Absolutely you can. The problem is that it doesn't have any nutritive value to you. So if you're trying to drink this water to be hydrated, meaning not to get dehydrated, you're not doing yourself any favors. All right? But if you mix it and make tea out of it, if you mix it and make any kind of a beverage, by all means. Don't drink distilled water, it's bad for you. But why? It's pure H2O. It's just not nutritive. If you're ordering stuff like Poland Springs or whatever, they actually sell you quote-unquote dirty water. Or water with all sorts of minerals that your body does need. This kind of dirt you need. The kind of dirt we get in a sink, we don't need. Because we don't drink clean water. We drink nasty water. I mean, maybe you do, I don't. And hopefully after this class, you will not touch any tap water for anything. And I urge you to take the quote-unquote Pepsi challenge to stop drinking or using tap water for anything in your house. Get off it. Purchase for yourself a pitcher called Zero Water in Target or Walmart for $40. Or just buy yourself Poland Spring water. Use that for 2 weeks. And then I dare you to fill up a glass of tap water in a cup and try to drink it. You will not be able to do that. First, your nose will burn from all the chlorine. Second, your tongue will feel like it wants to jump out of your mouth and run away far away because it's burning. Burning from all the impurities and all the garbage that's in the tap water. If you read the EPA report by your zip code as to what's in your water, your hair will turn white. Or it'll fall out one way or the other. But it's nasty. Yeah, you listen to that doctor.
Yeah, because sometimes when I'm trying to give them...
Yes, of course. Yeah, do not listen to your doctor when it comes to tap water. Do not give any children tap water. Do not give anybody any tap water. That stuff is nasty. I wouldn't wash my rear end with it. And I don't. I'm absolutely serious. Do not. Even my shower is filtered. Even my shower, I have a shower head filter. And, you know, in my previous house, I had a whole house filter, which hopefully I will install in my new place, but I haven't gotten around to it yet. But tap water, never, ever, 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 ever drink that stuff. I'll give you an example. Anybody here owns an iron that you iron clothes with?
Yeah.
Did you ever read any instructions on your iron? It says you can pour water in there, right? Yeah. But it tells you, do not pour tap water in there. Of course, and it says use only distilled water. How many people go out to buy a bottle of distilled water for their iron? Nobody says, my water is good. I mean, I live in Wellesley. My water is awesome over here. You pour it in there, you go on your clothes, and what do you see on your clothes? Stains. White stains, brown stains. You don't want to know what that is. That's all the crapola from water. When the water steam escaped as clean water from your iron, the dirt stayed on your clothes. There's a good reason why they tell you not to use tap water in there. And that's the reason, because all the nasties are going to get your clothes dirty. Dirty, dirty, dirty. Nasty, nasty, nasty. Don't believe me? Look in the bottom of your tea kettle. It's all the minerals and all the vitamins and whatever else they got in the water. It's not. It's also the rest of the crap. Just because the most abundant particle that's there is calcium carbonate, which is the same stuff that you find in Tums, okay, calcium that creates scale on your teapots or your toilet. Those brown stains in your toilet is not the stuff that comes out of your rear end. It's the water. If you have a leaking faucet, it's always brown underneath. It's not rust, it's scale. Okay, in any case, enough about that. Let's talk about reverse osmosis filtration. RODI. Reverse osmosis deionized filtration. we don't need to know at all what reverse osmosis is and what it entails, except for just a couple of things. Water in. So we have dirty water coming in. This will be our pre-filter. From the pre-filter, it goes into a reverse osmosis filter, and from reverse osmosis filter, it goes into the DI or deionizer. So we have a pre-filter. Usually pre-filter is a carbon or here's what they call it. GAC stands for granular activated charcoal filter. This guy removes big things from there, like some chlorine. It removes sand. It removes some of the calcium, you know, stuff from there, okay? And once we remove big things, we can put them through the reverse osmosis membrane, okay? It's a series of various filters which become smaller and smaller and smaller, at the end of which only H2O comes out. So we have pure H2O that comes out over here. But our last step right over here is something called the deionizer. For that, I have to teach you what an ion is. What is an ion? Well, ion is an electrically charged particle. Electrically charged particle. Now, I have to spend a little time and explain to you why is it that we are trying to deionize something. By the way, to deionize something means to remove the electrically charged particle. So we have electrically charged particles that have to go. Why do we care about electrically charged particles? I'll tell you. Because electricity damages metal. What are our surgical instruments made out of? Do we want to damage them with electricity?
No.
And that is why, because we don't want to damage them with electricity, we are going to deionize the water. Deionize the water, or remove the electrical charges from the water. So not only are you drinking nasty water, you're also drinking electrically charged water. Make sense? So we want to remove that. So we have a pre-filter, reverse osmosis filter, and the post-filter, or the deionizer, okay? To remove electrically charged particles from the water. Electrically charged particles in the water damage, discolor, and promote rusting of surgical instruments. Even though surgical instruments are made out of stainless surgical steel, there's no such thing as stainless or a stainless steel. All steel stains and all steel rusts. We'll talk about it in a different class when we discuss surgical instruments, but for now, I'm just going to say it so it kind of plants a seed in your mind. Okay? So remember, we have a pre-filter, which is the GACF, or granular activated charcoal filter. Okay? After that, we go to the reverse osmosis filter, and after that, we deionize it. So deionization is the last step in our filtration process. Is that clear? It'll be on the test, I assure you. So far, so good? This is the kind of water we need for washing, soaking, rinsing our instruments. Certainly for rinsing. Certainly. Does this make sense?
The final rinse, yeah?
Huh?
The final rinse.
Yes, the final rinse. Yeah. You're absolutely right. At least that. Make sense? And I will also explain why that is so. Now, I want to tell you something about dirty water. We have to know a few things. First things first, one of the words that you need to know is turbidity. Let's define turbidity. Turbidity is the visual dirtiness of water. So if you see that water is cloudy and dirty, okay, that's what turbidity is. So let's call it simple. Visual dirtiness of water. Can I erase this already? Or should I say may I?
Yes, you may, Stephen. Thank you.
Look at how much time we're spending on water, because it's important. One other word, or not a word, a few other things you need to know, aside from turbidity. Is something called TDS. TDS. We also need to know PPM. TDS stands for total dissolved solids. PPM stands for parts per million. Total dissolved solids. Having said that we have certain things called dissolved solids, the most common solid in the water is something called silicate, which is kind of, let's just say that it's sand. Another very frequent guest inside water is calcium. Now, it's not just calcium, it's calcium carbonate, but for the purpose of the examination, let's just stick to calcium. So calcium is also very common, but calcium very specifically makes water hard. So it's an interesting concept of having hard water. Now, I'll give you an example of what hard water is. Have you ever washed your glasses? I don't mean your glasses through which you, what do you call it, through which you read. No, I'm talking about glasses made out of glass so you can use it later, you know, to drink out of. You look at the work you did, and this glass is magnificently clean. You leave it on the dryer and you want to come back and you see, gee, I washed that glass so well, it's beautiful, it's sparkly. You come back and the darn thing is covered with white spots or runs and etc. So, oh my God, how did I miss all this? You didn't miss anything. That was the clean water that got dried up and left behind a visible trail of calcium deposit or hard water stain. And you find it in your shower, scaly buildup. My mom called me and says, son, my shower head doesn't work. Come in. My shower doesn't work. I get dribbles of water coming out of it, but everywhere else, water is working fine. Well, I instantly knew what was up. I went in, and my parents, they have these water saver shower heads. Okay? You can't really take a shower with them because it gives off this fine mist of water, but it doesn't waste any. But in any case, it stopped working. What happened? I unscrewed it. I showed it to my mom. I should have brought it to class. Because inside was covered by layers and layers of calcium and crap scale buildup inside there. You couldn't even wash it out. I mean, I could, but not worth my time. So I came prepared with a new shower head and I screwed it on. This is the stuff that comes out of the water. Okay? And if your shower head can get scaled up so no water comes out, imagine what happens in your guts as you're drinking tea. I'm just, you know, throwing things out there as we go along. Now, what is PPM? PPM is parts per million. Parts of what? Contaminants or dissolved solids. Of million what? Million molecules of water. So per millions of molecules of water, per 1 million molecules of water, we're supposed to have a certain acceptable level of contaminants. And believe me, million molecules of water is not a lot of water. It's a microscopic drop. Okay? If you can imagine what that is, you can't even see it. So, in any event, that's what PPM stands for. PPM is a unit of measure for TDS, for total dissolved solids. You need to understand this. How do we measure this? How do we find out total dissolved solids using PPM? Through the use of something called conductivity. I believe I already mentioned this. Conductivity. What happens? Let's use our imagination. This is our pot of clean water. It's pure H2O. What did I tell you about pure H2O? Pure H2O does not conduct electricity. Pure H2O does not conduct electricity. So if I stick an electrode over here and I would aim to conduct some electricity this way, nothing would come out this way. However, if I put some dirt particles over here, my electrical impulse would jump from here to here to here and to here. And based on this, I'm going to get some kind of a reading of electrical resistance on this end. So depending how much electricity is passing through, I can tell how dirty the water is. If a little bit of electricity goes through, the water is a little dirty. If a lot goes through, it's a lot dirty. So this is how we use conductivity to check and see if the water is pure. So if I ask you a question, how is water purity determined? Your answer will be, don't all speak at once. Say it.
Conductivity.
It will be on at least my test, and I can assure you that it'll be on the Isham examination also. So please remember that water purity is measured by conductivity. Our next topic of discussion will be detergents.